Over the past few years, the Red Hat and CentOS ecosystem has been in a state of flux. A few years back, completely killing off the CentOS project in the form it was traditionally known, replacing it with CentOS Stream. Now, whilst the names might sound similar, CentOS, CentOS Stream, there is a fundamental important difference. CentOS Stream is the upstream testing ground before things go into RHEL, whereas CentOS was a downstream of RHEL. It's not going to affect most people. Most people don't even need to care about it, but it is an important distinction. And then a year back, there was that whole Red Hat source code availability thing, which I think a lot of people have just completely forgotten about, putting distros like Alma Linux and Rocky Linux in kind of a weird position where they didn't exactly know what their future was going to look like. But projects like this have been chugging along, and recently, Alma Linux had a new announcement to make, introducing Alma Linux Kitten. Since we started building Alma Linux directly from the sources that Red Hat uses for Red Hat Enterprise Linux, we have been able to deliver bug fixes and security patches faster than ever before for our community. We still keep our promise of compatibility with RHEL, and every deviation from RHEL is recorded in our release notes, but our build and infrastructure teams have been embracing that freedom even more. This is something they started doing after the whole Red Hat source code stuff. They had to like grab the source code from the sources that Red Hat was getting them from, not grab them directly from Red Hat. Even so, most of the deviations they've made have been fairly minor stuff. It's just changing some branding stuff, adding a little bit of extra support for different architectures and things of that nature. Very, very little, like, actual substantial changes to the code, which to be fair is the way that most distros should be operating anyway. It's very rare that you have distros like Ubuntu, for example, or Manjaro that are going out of their way to cherry pick a bunch of additional patches that may not be tested by upstream, maybe in like a half development state, leading to a lot of additional problems. Most packages that you are getting are pretty much just clean packages directly from upstream. CentOS Stream 10, which will eventually be the source for RHEL 10, has already started being built and is available for use today. Because we anticipated many changes in 10, we wanted to get a head start on building Alma Linux OS 10. Earlier this year, we started setting up infrastructure and the build pipeline for Alma Linux OS 10 and started testing using CentOS Stream 10's code. Based on this preparation work, we are excited to share that we have successfully built a preview of Alma Linux OS 10 that we are calling Alma Linux OS Kitten 10, which is getting really annoying to pronounce. So this is not like a distro or a spin based on Alma Linux. It's effectively like a Debian SID or a CentOS Stream or pretty much just like a testing experimental branch to get things ready before you're actually, you know, shipping it as a final product. Now, whilst the similarities with the CentOS Stream model are blindingly obvious, this isn't just supposed to be basically like a renamed Alma Linux Stream, right? Like, it's not supposed to exist just for the purpose of there is a CentOS Stream, therefore there must be the same model in Alma Linux as well. CentOS Stream is a product of the CentOS community. It's the ultimate destination of the CentOS community work. Alma Linux OS Kitten is not a product at all. It is meant as a vehicle along the journey of development of the next version of Alma Linux. As I said, it's basically a development experimental branch. It's not really something that you're intended to, you know, use in production. We are using our freedom here to do a bunch of work in preparation for Alma Linux OS 10. Basically, just experimenting with things that sort of diverge a bit more from RHEL, which aren't like crazy breaking changes, where if someone relies on RHEL, they couldn't go and use Alma Linux OS 10 based on Alma Linux OS 10 Kitten or Kitten 10, whatever the order was supposed to be. Again, the name's a bit wordy, but this allows them to go and mess around with things before they get fully ready to ship them out. The first of those changes is re-enabling frame pointers. RHEL and CentOS Stream disable frame pointers by default, but with Alma Linux OS Kitten 10, we are re-enabling them. Now, Red Hat does provide documentation on how to go ahead and enable frame pointers on RHEL, but out of the box, they're gonna be disabled. Frame pointers are a very long-forgotten system involved in profiling that since about like 2004, people had been moving away from, and then there was about 20 years of people coming to the conclusion that, wait, maybe they were a good idea. Basically, the idea is when you're profiling an application, when you're profiling a system, you want to know what parts of that system are really causing like the high performance usage. So you know that if you want to go and optimize something, you're not just wasting your time optimizing something that just doesn't matter. Now, by not having frame pointers, you can't do a full stack analysis to know exactly what is going on. Some parts of it might get detached and placed on their own separate stack when they actually should be on top of one of these giant peaks here. So this is like a flame graph. It's a really good visual way of seeing like where there is like a lot of performance being used. Now, like many other things, the return of frame pointers basically began with the Fedora project, which brought them back, and then other distros brought them back, and it's becoming more of a trend to have them just available by default. Now, back in 2004, there were significant performance improvements by getting rid of them, but nowadays on modern systems, is just not worth it. Another change is Alma Linux OS Kitten includes an additional build using x86-64 v2. This is a fairly recent experiment some distros have been doing. Ubuntu had an experiment a couple of months ago. RHEL is doing the same thing, where they're moving up the baseline for x86-64 CPUs. So whilst we all use x86-64 CPUs on the desktop, unless you're, I guess, a Mac user, or for some reason you have like an ARM system, which is fairly unlikely, but most of us using x86-64. But early CPUs in this architecture don't have all the same functions that new CPUs in this architecture do. So over the years, there have been these groupings of different CPUs made in V1, V2, V3, and V4, which is a general set of features that CPUs in that range should have. The problem is they're not applied by the CPU manufacturers, they're applied after the fact. Anything post-2015 should be a V3 CPU, which is most of the people using something like RHEL. The problem is there are still V2 CPUs being made today, some of those barely being V2. If you go to V4, nobody can even agree what a V4 CPU is. And both in Alma Linux Kitten 10 and when we release Alma Linux OS 10, we will follow Red Hat's decision to ship x86-64 V3 optimized binaries by default. But we will also provide additional V2 architecture only for older hardware that doesn't support modern CPU feature sets. Again, it's not necessarily only older hardware. That's definitely the main case. But even so, there are some weird CPUs out there that for some reason exist. Do keep in mind that if you're using a third-party package that is built specifically for RHEL, it's only going to support V3. However, they are weighing the option of rebuilding EPL for x86-64 V2 users. If you use this version, please let us know by commenting on the RFC so we can make informed decisions about this version in the future. If nobody is going to be using any of these packages, or maybe it's like 5 people, it's probably not going to be worth the extra effort, and those users who need it can just go and compile packages themselves. Cure boot. Trusted boot has long been required for bare metal devices, and is also becoming more and more popular in virtualized environments. Alma Linux OS Kitten 10 supports secure boot for Intel/AMD and ARM platforms. I don't need to say anything more about secure boot. I know a lot of regular desktop people might have different opinions about it, but in the business world is, you know, fairly desired. adding spice, the simple protocol for independent computing environments, which has been unsupported since RHEL 9. Now, this is basically a remote display system built for virtual environments, which allows users to view a computing desktop environment, not only in the computer server machine, but anywhere on the internet. That's a line taken straight from the Wikipedia article. Basically, it's a remote desktop protocol that was developed by Red Hat, which they now instead recommend the use of VNC. The problem is VNC doesn't work in GNOME boxes. As a consequence, GNOME boxes is not available in RHEL 9. Now, they could have gone the other direction and ensured that Spice worked in GNOME boxes instead of getting rid of that, but hey, whatever. I don't know the reason why Red Hat does things. In that same version, they dropped KVM for IBM Power. IBM Power being weird IBM hardware using the IBM architecture that most regular people probably don't even need to care that it exists in the first place. Like, the only time you're ever going to interact with it is when it's being used as, like, the backend for something, or, like, you're using some, like, nice frontend that interacts with some... what doesn't matter. Moving on from that, we enable in Alma Linux OS Kitten 10's virtualization stack so it's possible to continue using KVM just like it is in Alma Linux 8. More hardware supported. Starting with Alma Linux 8.10 and 9.4, we re-enabled support for more than 150 devices that were removed upstream. We will continue that support in Alma Linux OS Kitten 10 as well as Alma Linux OS 10. Now, I feel like the reason why some of these were removed is sort of streamlining what they have to care about, because if RHEL says something is supported, that means they have to provide support for it, right? So it might just be easier to get rid of it if not that many people are using it anyway. Also, Firefox and Thunderbird are back in the sister repositories. Over on the CentOS Stream 10 and RHEL 10 side, they removed them in favor of using the Flatpak versions. Now, the Flatpak versions are officially supported here, so unlike doing it for Steam, for example, it's not that big of a deal, but they'd rather provide the user choice. If you want to use the Flatpak, use the Flatpak. If you want to use the standard package, go and use that instead. Now, these are the most notable and interesting changes, but they're not the only changes. And if you want to see the rest of them, check out the release notes for Kitten. It's not that long, and it's pretty well laid out, so you should be able to find anything you actually, you know, want to know about. Now, the most important question, more important than any of the functional changes and any of the reasons why you might care about this project, is why the name Kitten. Alma Linux has used cat names in our code names for our entire existence, and this felt like a perfect extension of that. This OS is the version that will grow up to be the next Alma Linux cat. So it's the development version of the cat. It's the unfinished cat. Therefore, it's the kitten. Yeah. More importantly, being a development version, it is going to get package updates fairly frequently, with images being rebuilt every 3 months, which I think is a fairly sensible model. I don't have anything to criticize there. Anyway, this is not something that most of you are going to want to run as, like, you know, the thing on your regular machine. This is very much oriented at, like, the business and server use cases, but also, it's a development branch and you probably don't want to use it anyway. But if you're an Alma Linux user, it's hopefully going to at least be a way for Alma Linux to continue improving. So let me know your thoughts down below. Are you someone who shouldn't, but does anyway, use development builds in production? Let me know so I can bully you. Anyway, if you liked the video, go like the video. And if you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, Scribes, LiberaPay link in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and go run the command on the board.
something like this.